Okay, you can start the lectures.
Okay, thank you. So, welcome. So, we will continue with the description of structure of stars. We looked at this Virial theorem, which we went through the derivation yesterday, starting from hydrostatic equilibrium equation. And we have noted that the general form of the Virial theorem, which says the gravitational binding energy plus 3 times adiabatic index minus 1 times the e-thermal, the total kinetic energy. This is the energy that is responsible for pressure. If it is thermal pressure, then it is the thermal energy. If there is any other source of pressure, then the kinetic energy belonging to that source of pressure will have to be used here. That equals 4 pi r cubed, where r is the radius of the configuration, times pressure at the radius of the configuration. If we are looking at an independent freestanding configuration, then the pressure at the surface is zero. So the right-hand side goes to zero. And we are left with Eg plus 3 gamma minus 1 Eth equal to zero. And for monoatomic gas, we can use gamma of 5/3, and then we get the familiar expression that Eg plus 2 Eth equal to zero. And that tells us the total energy of the configuration is negative, which is equal to minus E thermal. Now, a couple of interesting observations we can make right from here before we go into some more detail in stellar structure. So let's try to use this for a rough estimate for the sun. Here you see that, for the sun, we know the mass is 2 times 10 to the power of 33 grams. Radius is 7 times 10 to the 10 centimeters. So the gravitational binding energy, Eg, is negative. So if I look at the magnitude of Eg, which is roughly equal to gm squared by r, that works out to 4 times 10 to the power of 48 ergs. Now, Virial theorem tells us that the thermal energy should be half of this, which is roughly 2 times 10 to the 48 ergs. Now, what is thermal energy in this case? It is 3 by 2 times the number of particles times kT. The number of particles is roughly the mass divided by average atomic mass per particle. If it was pure hydrogen, then you just have M over MP, but here there is a mixture of hydrogen, helium, and other elements. So you have a factor mu, which is slightly larger than 1. So if you evaluate this, you will get something like 10 to the power of 57. So once you put all this together and you divide this thermal energy by 3 by 2 and n and k, that gives you an estimate of temperature, interior temperature. And from this simple consideration, you will find that the interior temperature is about 10 million Kelvin or 20 million Kelvin. And this is sufficient to ignite hydrogen and allow hydrogen fusing into helium. So the simple consideration of Virial theorem tells us that for the mass and the radius of the sun, the interior temperature is in the zone where hydrogen will burn to produce helium. Now, has the sun always been so? No. The sun did not form on day one with hydrogen fusion. All stars start their lives as diffuse gas in form of condensed clouds in the galaxy, typically molecular clouds. Now, parts of those clouds, due to local enhancement in density, become self-gravitating and then collapse and then further condense and eventually form stars. Now, in the process, as the condensation is going on, in the initial stages, the temperature is definitely not as high as 10 million degrees. So therefore, there is no fusion there. So initially, in a quasi-static manner, the stellar cloud collapses and condenses to higher and higher densities. So radius keeps reducing over time because the thermal energy is lost and thermal energy is not replenished by a source inside. So the total energy at any given stage is equal to minus the total thermal energy present. Now, the interesting thing is, suppose we start with a configuration which is at some radius for a given mass. That has a certain gravitational energy, which is given by the radius and mass. If the configuration has to collapse or contract to a smaller radius, then for the same mass, the radius decreases and the gravitational energy will increase. The magnitude of the gravitational binding energy will increase. So as magnitude of EG increases, it would mean that the thermal energy, which is half of that gravitational energy, will also increase. Now, two things to note here. If a configuration starts with some radius r and collapses to a smaller radius, the net thermal energy inside has now increased for the same number of particles, which means that the temperature will increase. So as the configuration contracts, the temperature will continue to increase. Now, the amount of gravitational binding energy that was released going from, let us say, some initial radius r1 to final radius r2, which is smaller than r1, let's say that is some delta EG, but the increase in thermal energy of the configuration, delta ETH, is only half of that, because ETH at any stage is EG by 2. So the contraction from R1 to R2 can only occur if the other half of the energy is taken away from the system. So the total energy is negative thermal energy by 2. But the total gravitational binding energy that is released is twice that. So the half the energy must be taken away in radiation for the system to contract. So if there was no radiation escaping the system, the equilibrium will continue at the current size. Or if the radiation that is escaping is exactly balanced by some source inside, like fusion, then also it will stay stationary at the current radius. So therefore, a self-gravitating system, which is contracting under its own gravity, if you take energy away from the system becomes smaller and it gets hotter. So by taking energy away, you have heated up the system. This is counterintuitive to the terrestrial experience, where if I take heat energy away from some system, it will cool down. Its temperature will not increase, it will go down. In this case, if you take heat energy away from the system in the form of radiation, the temperature goes up. There is no contradiction in it, because the loss of heat energy causes the system to contract and an excessive amount of gravitational energy being released, part of only part of which has been lost in radiation, the other part goes to increase the thermal energy. So this expression therefore gave us two things. One is that you can easily estimate the average interior temperature by doing the simple estimate from Virial theorem. And it also gave us an understanding that a self-gravitating system, in absence of energy production in the interior, will lose thermal energy. And as thermal energy is lost, it will contract and it will start getting heated up. So a self-gravitating system supported by thermal pressure can go only one way. As energy leaks out, it will continue to contract and will get hotter and hotter. At some point, it will get hot enough to ignite fusion. And then as long as fusion continues, it will find a stable configuration, a stable equilibrium. Once the fusion is over, then the same thing will repeat. It will continue to contract and continue to get hotter. So that is the standard evolutionary path of the self-gravitating gas globes. So having introduced that much, now let us try to get a very crude idea of the stellar structure. We know that hydrostatic equilibrium has to be obeyed. So the equation to solve is this, dpdr minus g m over r, m of r, rho of r divided by r squared. Solving this in a realistic case is a matter of numerical integrations and so on, which we will not do in this set of lectures. We will show you some results. But to get a feel, a dimensional approximate feel for what character the stellar structure has, we will do a very approximate and crude estimate of some quantities in stellar structure. Now, let's say the radius of the star is capital R, the center pressure is Pc, and the total mass of the star is M. Then I'll do a very drastic approximation and write this as a linear approximation. So dp, I will take the pressure at the surface, p at capital R, minus pressure at the center, which is pc, divided by the radius, which is capital R. Pressure at the surface is zero. Pressure at the center is pc, and the radius is capital R. On the right-hand side, I will replace rho as total mass divided by 4 third pi r cubed. And use this r as capital R, and use this m of r as total mass. So then this will give me pc over r is roughly equal to gm squared divided by r to the power of 4 times some numerical factor. Now, here, I can rewrite capital R using the value of M in terms of the average density rho. So rho is M by 4 third pi R cubed. So from there, I can write R in terms of rho. And I can write this right-hand side, once I have made the transformation, as Pc being equal to G m to the power of 2 thirds, rho to the power of 4 thirds. So we need an appropriate Pc which will equal this to get a balance. So this Pc, in case of a star like the Sun or in thermally pressure supported stars, comes from thermal pressure. So the equation of state connecting pressure and density is the thermal pressure equation, which is P equal to KT by mu n P, times rho. So P is proportional to rho and temperature. And this has to be large enough at the center to balance this quantity on the right to get an equilibrium configuration. So let's try to represent this graphically. On the horizontal axis, I have put logarithm of density. On the vertical axis, I have logarithm of central pressure. Now, from the first equation, where I put in a requirement for central pressure for a given mass and density, so g m to the power of 2/3, rho to the power of 4/3. So for a given mass m, this is a straight line in the PC rho diagram, in the log PC log rho diagram, with a slope of 4/3, because it's g m to the power of 2/3, rho to the power of 4/3. So this slope is 4/3 in log PC log rho diagram. If I take a mass which is larger, then I have a parallel line at a higher value, because the position of the line is also proportional to pressure, is proportional to m to the power of 2/3. So it will go up as m to the power of 2/3 as we go to higher and higher masses. So for different masses, I can then draw different lines in this diagram. This tells us the requirement of central pressure for a given rho for a mass that I choose. Now, this needs to be balanced by thermal pressure. So thermal pressure, the equation of state, is proportional to temperature times density. So I can draw lines for those as well. For a given temperature, this is just a line with slope 1 in P rho diagram. So for a given temperature T1, I can draw a line with slope 1. Now this line can intersect one of these black lines at some point. And where it intersects, then you have a possible equilibrium configuration where the central pressure due to thermal pressure at this temperature equals the required central pressure to balance gravity for this mass m2. So this will represent a equilibrium. So any of these intersections will represent possible equilibrium. For a given mass and a given temperature, you will always find an intersection at an appropriate density. As you can see from these diagrams, it so happens that for a given temperature, the equilibrium will occur at lower density as you go to higher mass. So let's take this temperature T1. The M1 will cross it at this density, which is very high, M2 at some intermediate one, and M3 at the lower end. M1 is larger than M2, larger than M3. Similarly, for a given mass, if you go to different temperatures, then the higher the temperature, the higher is the density at which the central balance will occur. Okay. So now, before I go to the next, so let's imagine this situation. Let's say I always go through thermally equilibrated configurations as the configuration of mass M1 evolves. But since initially the configuration is contracting, the density keeps increasing. As the density keeps increasing, the temperature for which the line crosses this black line will keep increasing as the mass, as the configuration moves along this line. That's constant mass, but contracting. So mass is constant, density is increasing. So the trajectory of the configuration is on this line. And the temperature can be got at any given point by looking at which of these red lines cross any particular point that you are interested in on this line. So if the configuration is here, there will be some temperature T0 which will cross here. Then as the configuration moves there, it is this temperature T1 which crosses there. And clearly T1 is greater than T0. So as the configuration moves along this line, the temperature continues to increase. As the temperature continues to increase, at some point, let's say once it reaches T equal to T1, T1 is sufficient to ignite hydrogen and start burning hydrogen into helium. Once that happens, then the energy being lost in radiation, which is the cause of the configuration continuing to condense, the thermal energy loss is compensated by fusion. Then as long as that compensation continues, no further contraction occurs. The object will stay stationary in this diagram at that crossing point. So if T1 happens to be the hydrogen burning temperature, then the configuration of mass M1 will find its equilibrium at this density. And that is the point where it will spend most of its life, because hydrogen burning is the largest phase of life of any star, and that is the main sequence. So at the main sequence, you have a certain density for this temperature T1, the T1 representing the hydrogen burning temperature. And that density will define what its radius is. If the configuration happened to be of a little higher mass, then the hydrogen burning, instead of starting at this density, it will start at this density. And this point then will represent the main sequence for mass M2, which is roughly at the same temperature, of course, because the same hydrogen burning process is ongoing. But the density is lower. And from this simple diagram, you can easily see that the density at the center of a main sequence star is proportional to 1 by square of mass. And that also tells you that the mass of the, that the radius of the star on main sequence is roughly proportional to mass. So radius is proportional to mass, density is proportional to 1 by mass squared, and temperature inside is roughly equal for all stars in the main sequence. If the hydrogen burning is over, then again, the compensation of the escaping radiation is lost. So this, let's say the main sequence for M2 had occurred here. Then after the main sequence is over, it will again start contracting and keep moving along this line. It will do so until the next burning reaction can be triggered. Now we have seen that you have to increase the interior temperature by almost a factor of 10 to get to the next burning stage, which is helium. And clearly, as it moves along this line, its interior temperature has no choice but to increase. So at some point, you will reach a temperature, let's say T2, where helium can burn. And then you will get the next phase of stability as long as helium is burning at this point. once helium burning is over, we will again further continue to higher stages of nuclear burning as you proceed to higher and higher density. So the helium burning will occur at a higher temperature and higher density at the interior of the star than the hydrogen burning in the same star. So with this very rough conclusion from the diagram, let's take a look at a few properties of the main sequence. As I said, the central temperature for the main sequence stars is decided by the hydrogen burning temperature, which is roughly about 1,000,000 Kelvin. So all main sequence stars, all hydrogen burning stars, have a temperature at the center which is roughly similar, within a factor of a few. So they're all a few times, 10 to the 7 Kelvin. So for the sake of this crude analysis, let's say all main sequence stars have roughly the same temperature at the center, which is TH. So the central pressure is then KTH by mu MP times rho, which is equal to GM to the power of 2/3 rho to the power of 4/3. And from this, I can easily rearrange this to see that it becomes rho to the power of 1/3. So, and we had gm to the power of 2/3 rho to the power of 1/3 is a constant. So rho is proportional to m to the power of minus 2, which is what I mentioned while examining the diagram in the previous slide. If rho is proportional to m to the power of minus 2, then r is proportional to m. And central temperature is proportional to m by r. This is not a surprise, because already we saw from Virial theorem, we have the thermal energy proportional to the gravitational energy, and gravitational energy is proportional to m by r. Now, the luminosity is something that you can observe of the star. So we looked at the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. In the vertical axis was luminosity, in the horizontal axis was the surface temperature. The surface temperature is not this temperature that we are talking about. This is temperature in the interior where hydrogen burning is occurring. So how can we estimate the luminosity of such a configuration? So luminosity can be estimated from this rough argument that we have a certain total radiative energy content within the star. And we can also estimate how much time it takes the radiation to escape the confines of the star. How can you estimate the radiation escape time? Let us say small l is the mean free path of propagation of photons. Then during one flight through the mean free path, it would consume a time which is equal to L by C. The question is how many such mean free paths it needs to cross before the photon can escape the star. Now we have the radius of the star equal to R. And each mean free path segment is of length L. So if this photon was propagating in a straight line from center to out, then the number of mean free paths it will have to cross is simply R over L. But the photon does not go in a straight line. It goes in a random fashion like Brownian motion. So the propagation is proportional to square root of the number of scatterings. So the time required is then proportional to square of the number of scatterings. And that's where the number of such mean free paths it will have to cross becomes equal to R by L squared. So R by L squared times L over C gives you the radiation escape time. Now, if we can estimate the mean free path, then we'll immediately be able to find an estimate of the radiation escape time. So mean free path is proportional to 1 by number density times the cross section, which we also write in astronomy as 1 by mass density times kappa. Kappa is sigma over mass per particle. This is a quantity which we call opacity in astronomical literature. So 1 by rho times kappa. So given that this is the radiation escape time, let us take the radiative energy content. Radiative energy content is nothing but the radiation constant times temperature to the power of 4 times the volume. A to the power of 4 is radiation energy density. So A times T to the power of 4 times R cubed divided by R squared by LC, which is the radiation escape time. So this will give you radiation constant times speed of light times mean free path times fourth power of the interior temperature times the stellar radius. So in main sequence, the luminosity is proportional to the mean free path times R, because the interior temperature is roughly constant, A is constant, C is constant. So L is, capital L is proportional to just L times R, which is proportional to L times M. So luminosity is proportional to mean free path times mass. Now, how does mean free path depend on the density and mass and so on? If the star is of high mass, the opacity comes mainly from Thomson scattering, for which kappa happens to be a constant. So L is simply proportional to 1 by rho, which is proportional to R cubed by M. So therefore, the luminosity on main sequence, once you put R cubed by M over here, and R is being proportional to M, this becomes proportional to M cubed. So for high mass stars, luminosity on the main sequence is proportional to cube of mass. While for low mass stars, the opacity you will probably learn in the radiative processes lectures, the process of thermal bremsstrahlung or free-free process. So free-free absorption gives you the primary source of opacity here. And that is proportional to T to the power of 3.5 by rho squared. And once you do a similar elimination, you can rewrite this as luminosity on the main sequence being proportional to M to the power of 5. So on an average then, luminosity on the main sequence is proportional to fourth power of mass. Now, since the total nuclear energy content is proportional to the mass of the star, on the other hand, the rate of energy consumption is proportional to the fourth power of the mass of the star, the lifetime of the star on the main sequence becomes proportional to 1 by cube of mass. So the higher the mass of the star, the shorter is the period it spends on the main sequence. The lower the mass of the star, the longer it spends on the main sequence. So this is very important and used very ubiquitously in astronomy for various estimates. So one can put all these concepts together and then construct what's called a theoretical Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. This is actually a theoretical Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, which has been constructed not by the rough arguments I presented in the previous slides, but by full solution of the stellar structure equation. But the rough characteristics are luminosity is proportional to m to the power of 4, radius is proportional to mass, and the effective temperature, which is given by the luminosity being equal to 4 pi radius of the star squared times Stefan constant sigma times T effective to the power of 4. So that is proportional to L by R squared. T effective to the power of 4 is proportional to L by R squared. So therefore, it is proportional to M squared. Hence, the luminosity becomes proportional to T effective to the power of 8 over here. So the effective temperature is log of effective temperature is on the horizontal axis here and log of luminosity on the vertical axis. So you get a very steeply rising function of temperature. Temperature goes from right to left here. Very steeply rising function of temperature. And that gives you the main sequence. And each point on the main sequence corresponds to a different mass of the star on the main sequence. So it's a sequence of masses strung along here. The lowest masses on the lower right-hand corner and the highest masses on the upper left-hand corner. So higher mass stars are more luminous, bluer, and spend much shorter time on the main sequence, as opposed to low mass stars that are redder, less luminous, smaller in size, and spend a lot longer time on the main sequence. The main sequence lifetime of the sun is about 10 billion years. And it has consumed about half of that by now. The main sequence lifetime, as I have said, is proportional to 1 by cube of mass. So if you go down to go up to 10 solar masses, then you are talking about only a few million years as the main sequence lifetimes of those stars. So at the highest end of this Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, the stars spend really very short time on the main sequence. So you can find many structures, many groups of stars in the sky, in the galaxy. For example, globular clusters, which are tight group of stars where stars of all masses had formed early tens of billions of years ago. Let's say 10 billion years ago. But now what you're left with are only the low mass stars. All the high mass stars have evolved and have disappeared from main sequence. So if you find a group of stars and then you find what is the highest mass star, which is still on the main sequence, that immediately gives you a way to estimate the age of that stellar configuration. Let's say the star cluster. So you, suppose you get stars up to 5 solar mass on the main sequence present in that star cluster. Then it's the main sequence lifetime of the 5 solar mass star is the age of that cluster. The older the cluster, the less is the mass of the stars that are still on the main sequence. Now here I have also indicated with the spectral types which I mentioned yesterday. So they are, represent different ranges of temperature. This is O, B, A, F, G, K, and M. And sun happens to be over here in G. Okay. So that is as far as I will go right now on thermally pressure-supported star. We'll make a digression now because we are talking about stellar structure, and we said that we need to solve the hydrostatic equilibrium equation with a certain equation of state. And the equation of state is nothing but a description of how pressure depends on density. In case of thermal pressure, the pressure depends on two parameters, the density and temperature. So it is a two-parameter equation of state. So therefore, you will need one extra equation to solve that, because that will need to fix the temperature as well. And that is done in case of normal stars by looking at the equation of energy transport, radiative energy transport. We will come to that in a little while. But before we go there, let us talk about another possible source of pressure which can hold up stars against their own gravity. And this is the so-called degeneracy pressure. This pressure is independent of temperature. So even a star at absolute zero temperature will still have this degeneracy pressure. So what is this mysterious degeneracy pressure? This degeneracy pressure comes manifestly due to quantum mechanics. We know that particles like electrons are elementary particles with half integral spin, with h cross by 2 in this case. Now, such particles, we also know, obey Fermi Dirac statistics, leading to what we call Pauli's exclusion principle. So, Pauli's exclusion principle tells us that if we define a quantum state, then only one such particle can occupy that quantum state. Now, if we define that quantum state regardless of spin, then at most two particles of opposite spin can occupy that quantum state. Now, we are used to defining these quantum states for bound systems where you have discrete energy levels, discrete quantum numbers, and we are used to applying this Pauli's exclusion principle, for example, to build the structure of an atom and so on. But this concept equally applies to continuum states, so particles which are moving around in free space. If we take the six-dimensional phase space consisting of three directions of position and three directions of momentum, then in this six-dimensional phase space, one can divide the whole volume into elementary phase space cells, quantum cells, of volume h cube each, where h is the Planck's constant. And these are individual quantum cells. Each of these cells may contain at most two electrons of opposite spin. Now, this leads to a very interesting result, that even if you do not give any thermal agitation to electrons, but if you have large number of electrons in a finite volume, then a momentum automatically appears because of this phase space cell occupation. Now, let's give a schematic example of that by drawing a one-dimensional case where we have the coordinate space x in the horizontal axis and momentum space px on the vertical axis. So let's say this is the bottommost one is p equal to 0. And then it's p equal to h, p equal to 2h and all that. So now I divide this phase space into individual quantum cells now of volume H in this one-dimensional example. And each of these can be populated by at most 2 electrons. Now let us say I have a finite volume. I do not allow the value of x to exceed a certain limit, which means I have confined the electrons to within that distance. So it is like confining the electrons into a one-dimensional box of that length. So I can keep filling electrons now. So first I will fill all of them at the lowest energy state or momentum state. So two here, two there, until I exhaust this. Once I exhaust this, if I start filling more electrons here, I can no longer fill them at zero momentum. I have to put them above here, which means that's a finite momentum. So I need to then populate this next set of states, which are at higher momentum. Once that is exhausted, I need to go further up in momentum and then fill these states. So now I have not supplied any thermal energy in here. It is simply populating electrons in a zero temperature system. But due to the Pauli's exclusion principle, we are forced to have electrons in finite momentum states. So now if I take this and then try squeezing it, so that means I take this x and then try to squeeze it further by going into smaller and smaller volumes, then clearly some of the electrons will have to keep going up to even higher momentum states, right? So therefore, the denser the material gets, the higher the momentum will rise. And this momentum, anything that has motion, carrying momentum, gives you a kinematical pressure, and that is the degeneracy pressure, which arises out of this Pauli's exclusion principle. So we can make an estimate of that in a realistic case. So now let us go back to six-dimensional phase space, and let's consider unit volume. So I will consider now only the momentum space with three axes, px, py, pz. And let's say I have certain number, any of electrons per unit volume, because this whole thing is for unit volume. So any number of electrons, any, can be confined within a phase space sphere, in momentum space sphere, of radius pf. So it is up to that, all the states are filled. So then I can immediately connect the value of any and pf, because the number of phase space cells is 4 pi by 3 pf cubed times 1. 1 is the configuration space volume. So 4 pi by 3 pf cubed times 1 divided by h cubed, because h cubed is the volume of each cell. That must be equal to any divided by 2, because each cell will take 2 electrons. So immediately from here, you can write the Fermi momentum, Pf, is equal to 3 by 8 pi to the power of 1/3 times Planck's constant H times any to the power of 1/3. So as any goes up, Pf will go up. Now once I have the momentum, I can compute the pressure from here. The pressure is defined as the momentum flux, which is, if I take a unit area, I count how much momentum is crossing that unit area per unit time. So number of particles crossing that unit area is number density of particles times the velocity of particles. So any times V, the particle flux. Each of these particles is carrying an average momentum P. So the pressure is simply any times V times P. Now this V is related to P, of course. If V is much less than C, we are in the Newtonian regime. We can write momentum is equal to ME times V. So V is P over ME. And for P, now I will use PF. And you can then take ME times P over ME times P. So ME times P squared. So P is proportional to ME. So P squared is proportional to ME to the power of 2/3 times ME. So it is ME to the power of 5/3. So P is proportional to number density of electrons to the power of 5/3 in the Newtonian limit. If we go to relativistic limit, where P has become so large that velocity has of particles have reached speed of light. So in that case, we just replace V by C. Therefore, there is no dependence on momentum here. So P then is proportional to ME times P, which is proportional to ME to the power of 4/3. So you have the degeneracy pressure, which is proportional to ME to the power of 5/3 at low density and ME to the power of 4/3 at high density. Now, ME can be connected to the mass density, because for each electron, there is a proton, and maybe there are also some neutrons. So let's say there are so many atomic masses per particle, which is mu e times the number of atomic masses per particle is mu e times the proton mass. So rho divided by mu e times mp is ME. So therefore, degeneracy pressure is proportional to rho to the power of 5/3 in non-relativistic case and rho to the power of 4/3 in relativistic case. This is for electrons. So if we draw this in the log PC, log rho diagram, we have our earlier M1, M2, M3, which go as P proportional rho to the power of 4/3 there. And we also have our T1, T2, T3. Let's say this is TH. And this blue line gives us the degeneracy pressure. It's proportional to rho to the power of 4/3 at low density, and rho to the power of 5/3 at low density, and proportional to rho to the power of 4/3 at high density. Remember, these lines also have a slope of 4/3, so it becomes parallel to these lines at high density. Now, the degeneracy pressure does not disappear as the star cools. So once a configuration is supported by degeneracy pressure, unless the configuration is disturbed externally in some way by adding more mass or by colliding it with something, this configuration will stay in the same situation forever. So now let us look at the balance of central pressure with gravity for in the presence of all these sources of pressure. So let's take this M1. So M1 contracts, and then at this point, it is crossed by the degeneracy pressure. So once it crosses, is caused by degeneracy pressure, it finds an equilibrium which is long lasting. So therefore, the configuration will not move further down this line anymore. So therefore, this configuration M1 will stop its contraction here. It will stay at this density. It will never go further down in this line to cross TH, and therefore it will never ignite hydrogen. So this configuration will not become a star. On the other hand, M2 will cross TH at some point, and it will become a star. And then once so this is main sequence over here. Once main sequence is over, it will further contract, and maybe, depending on the mass, go through further levels of nuclear burning. And eventually, the collapse will be halted by electron degeneracy pressure. And it will find a long-term equilibrium over here. Such an object is called a white dwarf, something that has gone through a stellar nuclear burning stage and then is held long-term by electron degeneracy pressure is called a white dwarf. Now, if the mass happened to be larger than this line, then you can see this is the mass of the core. Then you can see that degeneracy pressure actually cannot support such configuration. So M3 as the core mass will never have a degeneracy pressure supported configuration because it doesn't cross it. So there is a critical limit up to which the degeneracy pressure support is available. So that is called a limiting mass. And we will start from this limiting mass in the next lecture. We will stop our lecture today and then take questions. Okay. Anjali, go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you said that the degeneracy pressure, it would support the star. But then, if the degeneracy pressure has already supported the star, what is the effect of the gravitational force?
Gravitational force is holding the star together. Degeneracy pressure is supporting it against the gravitational collapse. If the degeneracy pressure was not there, then the star will contract further under its own gravity. Right? So degeneracy pressure provides the support. So that gives you the equilibrium configuration. Now, it need not be a star. For example, this M1 will receive degeneracy pressure support even before it becomes a star. And such a configuration is called a brown dwarf. It never ignites hydrogen, but it gets supported by degeneracy pressure even before it gets dense enough and hot enough to ignite hydrogen. So there are a whole lot of such objects which are called brown dwarfs. And then there are stars which go through nuclear burning and then gets halted by degeneracy pressure. They're called white dwarfs.
So, sir, this is like sort of a condition on whether an object can actually become a star.
Yes. And that is why I have noted here the excluded zone. So you should not find any configuration in this blue region. There are no equilibrium configurations which will reach this blue region because degeneracy pressure will support them all before they reach here. So all these lines which intersect the hydrogen burning line on the right-hand side of this within the excluded zone will not occur at all.
Sir, and one more thing that you said, that for the M core line, so it will, you are telling that it will not be supported by degeneracy pressure, so it will continue hydrogen burning, and at some stage, after helium burning, it will automatically start to go on to the cooling stage of white dwarfs, right?
Once it gets supported by degeneracy pressure, white dwarf will occur when the degeneracy pressure support becomes available. Yes, and then it will cool because it cannot contract any further. Degeneracy pressure is holding it. Thermal pressure is no longer important. Okay.
Sir, at that stage, the entire burning has stopped and just the star is supported. So the thermal energy is just getting radiated out, right?
Yes.
So at some point, like, what will happen when the entire thermal energy has radiated away?
It will become this cool, very dim object, but nothing will happen to its structure. It is held by degeneracy pressure, it will stay forever.
Sir, but yeah, this was one question. Like, if the degeneracy pressure you told at the beginning that it will never ever change, but as the density changes...
Density is not changing anymore. Thermal pressure is not the supporting pressure. So as heat goes away, it is not moving from here. It stays at this density. Nothing changes. Right? So density remains the same. Temperature changes, But radius remains the same, mass remains the same, it just stays there forever.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, I'll go to the next one. Junik Sengupta, I'll ask you to unmute.
Hello, sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. So my question is, after the star core has reached the iron or the nickel fusion reaction state, is it possible that degeneracy pressure can further hold it in equilibrium at that stage?
I will come to that later in stellar evolution. There are complications there, which I will discuss later in the course. We'll just wait for it.
Okay, sir. So actually, I had a second question from previous lecture. Can I have it now?
Okay.
Actually, this question is also related to that portion only, the iron and nickel cores fusion reactions. As in last lecture, you said fusion, after the iron and nickel core fusion reaction happens, the star cannot supply further energy by from these fusion reactions. Is this the stage where the super, after this line crosses this core reaction,
yes,
at that stage, is this the condition where the supernova happens?
Yes, that is right. So I will discuss the condition for supernovae later. So
okay.
We'll talk about it.
Okay.
Okay. Next, Nihar Ranjan.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. Can you please discuss shortly the reason of excluded zone in the last slide?
I thought that's what I just described. Because all stars approach from the left. They're diffuse large radius objects and gravity brings them to higher and higher densities. So initially everything is on the far to the left. So you're approaching this region always from the left. As the thermal energy is taken away, the star contracts and eventually it moves along, a given mass will move along this straight line. How far can it go? It can only go as far as being stopped by degeneracy pressure. Once it is stopped by degeneracy pressure, it cannot contract anymore. So therefore, it can never enter the right-hand side here.
Yes?
Come from the left, it will get stopped here. Come from the left, it will get stopped here. So this is a barrier. Okay, next. Jyotirmoy.
Yes, sir. Sir, in the previous slide, this degeneracy pressure. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, this one. So this third line means how it is coming, that n e by 2 means how 2 is coming.
Because each cell has 2 electrons, no? Each cell can take 2 electrons of opposite spin. So. So you need to have only n e by 2 pairs. And the question is how many pairs? N e is the number of electrons. So how many pairs? N e by 2 pairs. So each cell can accommodate one pair.
And this sums 4 by 3 pi in PF cube. And PF is connected with the H from this Heisenberg constant principle, del P.
Yeah, you can call it. Yes.
Then if a PF cube, H cube, then one 8 term is also there. They say del X into del P equal to H by 2.
No, no, it is not coming. It is not coming from del X, del P. It is coming from a 3-dimensional volume in the phase space, which is 4 pi by 3 PF cubed times the configuration space volume, because the configuration space volume is 1 here. I have taken unit volume. So that is the total volume. Each cell has a volume of H cubed. If you go to statistical mechanics, you will see how that is defined. So each quantum cell has a volume of H cubed. So how many cells are there? How many distinct cells are there? Is the total phase space volume 4 pi by 3 PF cubed times 1 divided by H cubed. That is the total number of individual phase space cells, right? Individual quantum cells. Each of them can contain one pair of electrons. And we know there are any electrons in that same phase space volume. So the number of pairs is n e by 2. This any by two pairs is distributed in so many different cells, and they're all filled, so therefore each cell will have two electrons. Okay. Go to Priyanka Patel.
Hello, sir. Sir, I have a very basic question. Like on the basis of main sequence, like with respect to the main sequence, we are identifying the types of stars, like white dwarf and brown dwarf and everything?
No, main sequence is only one part of the HR diagram. Right?
So, sir, the stars lying on the main sequence, do we have the specific name of that stars?
The names of those stars?
Yes, sir. Like the stars which are lying... Stars.
There are billions of stars in the main sequence. You want to give names of each of them?
No, sir, not like that. I mean the types of stars. We have the giant stars, then super giant stars, and so on.
No, they're all out of main sequence. Main sequence is one category. Giant is another category. Super giant is another category. White dwarf is another category. So they're all outside of main sequence.
So the stars which are lying on the main sequence, so what do we call them? We call them
main sequence stars.
Okay, sir.
Main sequence is the name.
Okay, sir. What? Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. All right. Neil.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
So I wanted to know how would the degeneracy pressure be different in a white dwarf compared to a neutron star?
I have not discussed neutron stars, so I will address this question when I discuss neutron stars, okay? Because there are other issues I have to discuss before that.
Okay, sir.
Saurabh Pal?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, please go to the thermal pressure support slide.
This one?
Yes, sir. Sir, firstly, I want to ask, in the main sequence, all hydrogen is burnt or not?
What do you mean, all hydrogen?
You said that when the star reaches in the main sequence in the hydrogen burning temperature, so if it reaches the hydrogen burning temperature, so hydrogen is burnt, so all the hydrogen does all the hydrogen burns or not?
No, I already mentioned that yesterday. It is only the central 1/10 of the mass where nuclear fusion occurs. So the hydrogen burns there, not in the entire star.
Okay. So, sir.
Because temperature is highest at the center and temperature is lower outside. So the whole star is not at the hydrogen burning temperature. Hydrogen burning temperature occurs only in the center.
When it reaches the T2, I'm telling in case of M2, when it reaches T2, then it takes hydrogen from the rest hydrogen. It takes the fuel from rest of the hydrogen.
No, what do you mean by rest of the hydrogen?
Means
once hydrogen only once, right?
Yeah.
Before that, there is no hydrogen burning. It takes whatever region of the star has sufficiently high temperature, it will burn that hydrogen. That is the first fusion reaction. Before that, there is no fusion reaction.
Yeah. Thank you. And sir, my question is, do you name some of the books on the stellar peaks?
Okay, I mean, there are many books. You can see.
Means one or two, if you said that will be helpful.
You can look at Dina Prialnik's book. I don't know what you can find easily. You need access to a library, or in the net, you have to see what you can find. There's a book by Dina Prialnik, which is reasonably readable undergraduate. So I think you can try that. For a good quantitative description, Kippenhahn and Weigert, it's a Springer book. That is a standard textbook for stellar physics. No, but I don't know if you can find it on the net.
Okay, sir, I will try.
Okay, Ishika.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, from the last slide, where we stopped.
Yes.
So here, as the density is increasing, the dependence of PC and density, it's moving from non-relativistic regime to relativistic regime. So why is it so?
Okay, so if density increases, you go to the previous slide. If density increases, momentum increases, right? If momentum increases, velocity increases. And as you go to higher and higher velocities, at some point you reach the velocity of light. Then you reach the relativistic regime. So at high density, this equation of state applies. At lower density, this equation of state applies. Okay? Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I won't be able to take any more questions now. It's 12:40. So keep your questions. Maybe you can write them down somewhere.
I have a small announcement regarding this, Dipankar. So after you finish, I'll make the announcement.
Yeah. So I'll just take a quick look at the chat box and see if there's anything which needs immediate addressing. The distance of the stars are measured not from their luminosity. You have to measure them independently. And the parallax is used for that, for most of the stars now in our galaxy. With Hipparcos and Gaia, there are lots of parallax measurements, and that's what we use. We do not use luminosity to do distance calculation because we will have to know various other properties of the star. And it is not redshift. Redshift is applicable only for distant galaxies. And here we are talking about stars within our galaxy, so therefore redshift cannot be used for distance measurement. Okay. So yeah, we can stop now. Thanks.
Okay, so before we finish for today, just a small announcement to all the participants, and you will find that in the PB Works workspace webpage, next to the columns of the different lectures, there in the miscellaneous info section, there is a new entry called Q&A. And you click that, for each of the separate topics, you'll go to a form where you can submit a question to the instructor. So we'll collect all the questions and pass them on to the different instructors. And provided if they have time after the lectures, they will try to address them. So if you have any questions that you were not able to ask because of limitations of time, please go to the form on the PB Works webpage under the miscellaneous section, and you'll understand what to do. And for those who have not still received the invite for PB Works, please check your spam folder once again. If it's still not there, then write again to us at isar@iuka.in. That is all for now. So if there's nothing else, Dipankar, then we can close the meeting.
Yeah, so we will close it. We'll close it today. All questions which are not addressed, please collect them together at some point. We will try to address it.
Thank you.
Thank you.